here. It's also a senior researcher in the program of scientific defense in Argentina. She's a member of the National Academy of Sciences since 2007. She's director of the CIMSO, which is the Center for Research of Solids, that belongs to the National Research Council, CONICET, and is placed in the CITEDEF, which belongs to the Defense Ministry. She has written more than 350 scientific papers, and she has been the advisor of more than 30 PhD theses. She is well known in the area of ceramic materials and be in charge in the next talk.
I'm thankful to the organization for the invitation, and I shall try to communicate with what we are doing with the nanostructure materials that we use for intermediate temperature fuel cells and for gas sensors. Gas sensors is the next lecture part. Well, we made work at CIMSO. CIMSO is a center of research in solids, which belongs to CITEDEF and CONICET. Well, nanostructured ceramic materials are synthesized, characterized, and applied for fuel cells and gas sensors, as I have already said. But we use nanomaterials. Why do we use nanomaterials? They give so much difficulties to synthesize and to characterize them. Well, these materials have a crystallized size with diameters which are more or less of the same dimension than the distance or critical length of some phenomena, like the Broglie wavelength for electrons, or the mean free way of excitons, or the required distance of a loop of dislocation, the Frank Reed loop of dislocations. Or the thickness of a space charge that we shall see in our next talk. These nanomaterials are characterized by surface effects which dominate the thermodynamics and the particles' energy, And so crystalline structure, surface morphology, reactivity are completely affected by the diameter of particles and by a very extended surface. Well, these nanostructured ceramic materials, we made a synthesis, the structural and electrical and optical characterization, obtaining really new materials, in spite that the same materials are used usually as microcrystalline materials with quite different properties. Different properties and new applications. Well, this synthesis is made by many different synthesis methods according to the properties that we are asking for of that material. We use gel combustion. It was used during a long time in our set. We are working in this material for 10 years. Deep coating, spin coating, precipitation, milling. Well, the process of synthesis are always adapted according to the properties, required properties. And of course, the characterization is quite different if we are using nanomaterials. We use BET isotherm to determine the specific area. We use SEM or CAN, but especially high resolution TEM spectroscopy. And steer X-ray diffraction to determine the crystallized size by a Scherer equation and to determine to adjust the parameters by Richter method. And it is very important for our kind of work to use the synchrotron techniques, which are special for nanomaterials. So from more I think from 9 or 10 years, we have a very fluid exchange with the synchrotron in Brazil and gel combustion method, as I have said, is one of the most used. It's a very simple scheme to know that raw materials with the material with which we want to make the solid oxide, metallic solid oxide, is treated with nickel. Afterwards, it is treated with the fuel. The fuels are citric acid, glycine, alanine, lysine. In general, all these types of words are the results of doctoral thesis, which are made in our work, as you can see afterwards. Well, thermal concentration enables us to make a gel and a combustion. A combustion, well, we see very, very easily that after combustion ashes. After combustion are produced by an excess of fuel. And after calcination, the powder is very fine particles from 2 to 10 nanometers in general of the materials that we are using. Also, the coating is used. Well, I show you some characterization with the high resolution 10. We have no 10 in our institute, and we use the Titan 300 from the Stefan Institute in Ljubljana, Slovenia, with which we have also a very fluid collaboration. Well, it is only to illustrate. like the conference because here you can see the atoms. It is true that at the moment it is possible to see the atoms in two particles and to know the characteristics of the green boundary is what we are interested in. Well, the synchrotron techniques, I shall not stay for a long time with that. Well, in this case, we shall speak about the use of nanostructured materials, ceramic materials, to obtain fuel cells. But fuel cells, in our case, are not the conventional fuel cells which are operated at high temperature. High temperature fuel cells that are near to be commercialized, and they are working at 800 to 120 centigrade. In our case, our fuel cells can operate from 550 to 750 centigrade. It is really a goal to spare so much energy with this kind of batteries. Well, the present energetic situation show us serious problems like global heating, environmental contamination, not only by toxic gases, also by noise, energetic crisis, and irregular energy distribution, and lack of fuels. Consequently, new energy systems are required, more friendly with the environment and highly efficient. Fuel cells, especially the cells which are developed in our sensor, is constitute an alternative form. The kind of fuel cells is soft, that is to say, solid oxide fuel cells. Well, which are the advantages of fuel cells? They do not exceed the limitations of thermal machines. They can theoretically reach a very high efficiency from 95% theoretically. A real efficiency is from 65 to 67 percent. They do not emit toxic gases. With in general, this kind of batteries can work, as we shall see, with hydrocarbons, with natural gas, with biogas, and if we use hydrogen, of course, it is not produced inside the cell, as we shall see. Hydrogen is used as fuel, is the best situation. Of course, the greenhouse gases can be completely avoided. They do not present mobile pieces, so noise is not very important. Well, I speak very well about this kind of fuel cells, but why they are not usually used still? Well, they are not still used because the technology is expensive, and is more expensive than the one of the usual fuel, of the usual cells that we know. Well, these fuel cells to create electrical energy, in spite that in this moment, hydrogen is not used, it is only used for the PEM fuel cells, that protonic fuel cells, but they need hydrogen, very pure hydrogen, and this very expensive to produce the hydrogen and to the storage of hydrogen. So it is very interesting if we can use hydrocarbons or natural gas for our cells. The solid oxide fuel cells exhibit a high efficiency. And here we make the first comparison from conventional high temperature fuel cells and the intermediate temperature fuel cells. In this case, the high temperature makes the reforming, internal reforming of hydrogen in the cell. That is to say, it takes a fuel hydrocarbon and produces hydrogen inside the cell. That is internal reforming. But in our case, it is an oxidation of the fuel in the anode, as we can see soon. In both cases, it is possible to make the reform inside the cell. That is a very interesting goal of this type of cells. Actually, these fuel cells function with natural gases, biogas, and hydrocarbons. We are now working with the garbage gases, and it is interesting that because garbage we shall have garbage for a long time, forever, and it is not very expensive, and it is useful to feed our cells. As you can see, afterwards all these kinds of feeding of our cells. Fuel cells are again electrochemical devices enabled to convert the chemical energy into electrical energy. Here are the scans of two different cells, but in both cases, hydrogen is produced inside the cell and reacts with the oxygen of air producing water in both cases. But which are the difference? The difference is that here the conducting ion is a protein, while in our case, the case of soft batteries, the conducting ion is oxygen valences. Well, in solid oxide fuel cells, in high temperature, the conventional fuel cells have a higher efficiency of 60-65%, it is proved. They do not need noble gases, noble metals, as catalyzer. In our case, when we are working with the lower temperature fuel cells, we have the possibility to avoid the damage of materials which are built fuel cells, because temperature is not so high. How it operates? Well, the anode in the high temperature soft is formed with nickel and yttrium stabilized zirconia. And the anode is in contact with the fuel. The fuel can be, as we have already heard, with hydrogen and also with hydrocarbons. Well, and the cathode is made of manganese, lanthanum, strontium, manganese, which are in contact with air. This is the conventional model. The conventional one. And now we shall try to convince you why we use nanomaterials. There are many advantages of use the nanomaterials. They enable to retain conductive phases which are stable at lower temperature. This is a very well-known equilibrium phase diagram of zirconia yttria. Here, zirconia has a doping of yttria of 8%, 8.2% molar yttria. Well, in this cubic phase, the material is a good conductor. But there is another phase, the trigonal phase, which is also a good conductor. But it is impossible to retain this phase by quenching or by a natural method used by in ceramic studies. And so, when we use nanomaterials, it is possible to retain this tetragonal phase, which is working at lower temperature. See, you can see here that at 600 centigrade, it is possible to have a material which is a good conductor, as good as the cubic phase. And it is not necessary to use a large quantity of yttria, as in this case. Well, I have to be all honest and say that this kind of arrangement was not possible to make successful. Because it was not successful because there are problems with humidity. But anyway, I think it is possible to understand why we use nanomaterial to retain the phases, and we will see real cases made in our group. Well, there are, from the high temperature fuel cells, technological problems to solve, especially to decrease the operation temperature, increase the efficiency, simplification of the design, we shall see also a good example, and of materials for convenient operations with natural gas or hydrocarbons, to lower the cost and to use different separating materials. It is interesting that if we can work with an operation temperature, a lower operation temperature, then it is possible to preserve the materials from heat damage. Well, if we are working now, we compare with the high temperature operation. The intermediate temperature soft work, as I have already said, from 550 to 5750 Celsius. And for the electrolytes, all the electrode materials are synthesized in our group. In this case, we were working with cerium oxide, ceria dot with samaria, with gadolinia and yttria. We have also proof with perovskites, which are oxides from lantan and zirconium, but with gallate and magnesium. And zirconia dot with scandium. Cathode materials. Well, the new cathode materials, of course, we have to change. If we reduce the temperature, we have to change the materials which are forming this kind of fuel cells. The cathode materials implies to use cobaltites or cobaltite ferrites, all these cobaltite ferrites which are mixed conductors, and we shall see why. Mixed conductor, that is to say, materials which are conducted by the oxygen vacancies and by electrons. Well, in the cathode, it is produced the oxygen reduction. In the anode, it is production, the fuel oxidation. And this subject requires a major research. It is a point in which we are working hard, because it is necessary to have materials with a good response to the oxygen, to oxidize the anode. And silica-based materials are used in our case. Well, I am always comparing the same things for the high temperature fuel cells and for the intermediate temperature. And I shall compare also the results. High temperature anodes produce an internal reforming, as we have already said. That is to say that methane, we can use another hydrocarbon, plus water, gives us hydrogen, a fuel, and a carbon monoxide. Well, departing from methane and carbon dioxide, we have the same compound. After these gases react with oxygen ions, giving water and giving carbon dioxide. Well, that is the case of high temperature anodes. Now we are thinking in lower temperature anodes, that is to say, intermediate temperature fuel cell. In this case, it is produced a direct fuel oxidation. Methane reacts with oxygen, giving water and carbon dioxide. It's a direct oxidation. And I am introducing now another type, another design from the same type of fuel cell. Because here is the partial fuel oxidation produced in one chamber cell. We shall see what I mean. A methane reacts with oxygen, giving hydrogen and carbon monoxide. What is a one chamber shock? A one chamber, so in the first scheme of a fuel cell, we have seen that the anode receives the fuel while the cathode is in contact with the oxygen. In this case, the design is improved because we can save material and it is not necessary to have two different chambers. In this case, we have a mixture of hydrocarbons plus air, and this, the cell, the whole cell, is in contact with this cost control mixture of hydrocarbon and air. And then what we have is anode materials and cathode materials, which are selective, which are a little intelligent, because they make the selection of the gas that they are using. In this case, the anode will make the oxidation of the fuel, and the cathode will make the reduction of oxygen. Well, and now we can compare results. It is interesting to make both in both experiences one chamber, in both cases one chamber soft. This is the high temperature soft, which is working at 950 centigrade. It is in contact with methane, and the ratio between methane and oxygen is 1:1. Well, what we have here? We have here the voltage in function of current density. Voltage in current from in the function of current density in milliampere per square centimeter. In this case, we have power density in milliwatts per square centimeter in function of current density in milliampere by square centimeter. I shall try your to show you something interesting. In both cases, we have used nickel oxide. It is the usual material used for anodes. And another material which was designed in our room of nickel oxide and a mixture of oxide of zirconia and 70 molar percent of CdO. You see that the behavior with this kind of anode is really better. Well, but it operates at 950 centigrade, and the maximal power density in milliwatt per square centimeter is, in case of using nickel oxide, of 40, and in case of the other anode material, of 55. I take your attention for this case because in the following, we have one chamber intermediate soft, which is working from 550 to 750 centigrade. And in this case, the anode that we use is an anode of Syria. We have to change because we use a lower temperature, which is 10 molar percent dot with samaria, and it is also added palladium oxide. Why we use palladium oxide? It is a good catalyzer. Well, but I have to show you that in this case we are working at 600 centigrade, that is to say 350 centigrade lower temperature. And if we compare the power density in milliwatts per square centimeter, in this case we have for a lower temperature fuel cell a 100 milliwatts per square centimeter. Results show that it is interesting to follow with experiences in these materials, enabling to obtain this kind of fuel cells. Besides, another advantage is of using nanomaterials. When we have mixed conductors, do you remember that we have spoken of electrodes made of mixed materials? That is to say, mixed conducting materials are conducting by ions and conducting by electrons. Well, mixed conductors favor the reactions of the electrons. If you have a very conventional electronic conductor, then we have reaction in the triple point, which is electron, gas, and electrolyte. In only points of that, it is possible to have a reaction, which in case of mixed conductors, it is in all the interface or surface between electrode and gas. But if we have nanomaterials, this surface is it is a very white surface. It is a very important surface because we have nanomaterials. And then the reaction is increased just by the type of surface that we have with this nano material. Another advantage is with regards the nanostructure electrolytes. In this case, we were working with base silver electrolytes. And when we were studying the diffusion in the electrolytes, we have found one or two orders of magnitude of a more enhanced diffusion that we have measured by age, of course. Here you see in the range plot, plot for different grain sizes, different diameters of the particles. And as the particle was with a smaller diameter, we had a higher diffusion. Well, we studied the transport mechanism. It is based on a very fast transportation through the grain boundaries of oxygen vacancies. And they migrate by a translational movement, which is delocalized with a big hop. It is not the usual hop that we use, that we have seen in the future. In contrast with the conventional microcrystalline materials, in which there is a localized jump, then we have a more conductive or enhanced conductivity in the electrolytes. Another advantage of using nanomaterials. Well, with all these advantages, it was possible to make the design of an experimental intermediate temperature fuel cell. The fuel, as always, it was in contact with the anode. In this case, the anode was made of mesoporous zirconia treated with silver. The nanostructure electrolyte was in ceramic silver base or silver zirconia base. And the cathode was obtained with nanotubes of cobalt. And nanotubes of cobaltites are in contact with air. This is our cathode. Why do we use nanotubes? Another advantage. In case of using nanotubes, as we shall see in the next one, I think it is the result. It is possible to have a more important, with the nanotube, a more important surface. The surface reaction is increased. Coming a little back, this is the enhancement that I told you of diffusion, which was also found in zirconia doped with scandia electrolyte. It was the doctoral thesis of one of our students, who is now working in the synchrotron in France. In this case, an enhancement of the total ionic conductivity, about 50%, was found only with fine grain ceramic. It was not necessary to reduce to nanomaterials, but with a very fine ceramics of 0.5 micrometers, it is not millimeters, it's micrometer, it was possible to have an enhancement of diffusion of 50%. Then we come back to the exhibit an excellence, an excellent performance if we are measuring the specific area with bed absorption measurements. And then it increases the number of reaction points. Here is a magnification of the cathode, which was also used in the experimental model of fuel cell. Each of these reactions in each electrode and in the electrolyte are the studies made for the a PhD of our students. This is a PhD in development of Leandro Acuña, and he is working in cathodes of ferrites with barium and strontium. Cobaltite ferrites with barium and strontium. The cathode was obtained by a lyophilization synthesis, and the electrolyte was Celia dot with Carolina. Well, zirconia dot with Celia enabled to see metastable phases for the anode materials. In this case was the doctoral thesis of Ismael Fabregas, and now is just finishing Genoveva Simics and study for these materials. Solid solutions of zirconia, here it is not core to set up in, because it is a very important concentration of these materials. Zirconia, Celia, presents metastable forms of the tetragonal phase. The tetragonal phase is a lower temperature and is a very good conductor. And there is also the catalytic properties which are very interesting for methane oxidation. These materials are mixed conductors in reducing atmosphere. It is due to the change of valence of cerium from 4 plus to cerium 3 plus. There are some difficulties to apply this solid solution because they are degraded at high temperature and by the volume change which is produced by this kind of reduction. CINSO is also now studying the performance of anodes based on cernets, and cernets are produced as solid solution of zirconia and cilia. Well, this is the most important thing in our group, which is the group itself. Not everybody from this group is working in nanomaterials for fuel cells, but a little group is working in the sensors, of which I shall speak next also. Well, this is the most important thing in our group, and I give you thanks for your attention.
Okay, do we have any questions for the speaker? Everybody's tired after the whole day.
What's the efficiency on the fuel cells that you've been producing?
60% till now, but I think it will be better at the end of the year. We have some problems with the materials because we are always looking for better materials, and we have changed in general, I think they are going well with the Syria oxide, but with Samaria, with Scandia. There are also problems that I did not mention about the mechanical properties. For example, Scandia is very fragile, and it is not good to have any stacking of unit cells when the material is a little fragile.
Are there any questions? If not, we thank the speaker.